impact and bring it out if required in the form of narrative reporting for enhanced transparency to investors, determining the materiality from a sustainability angle of reporting, and lastly, even though it is not voluntarily required, you can engage external review and assurances of sustainability related disclosures. You can do that today. So this three ingredients of embedding sustainability into the DNA of the organization has been brought out beautifully in this IFAC PAB's framework, and this has also been embedded into one very good paper released by IFAC called Competent and Versatile Professional Accountant in Business. Who is the competent, professional, versatile accountant in business? Is he the one who engages only in compliance? This paper says absolutely no. A real competent and versatile PAB looks beyond compliance of accounting standards and auditing and gets into all these issues. So this has been integrated into that paper as well. So now I finish my first bullet point. Let's go to the next. I'm skipping this. What questions this framework answers, I had in mind to answer. I'm skipping this. Go to the next slide. This is the contents of the BCG's survey on sustainability, which has brought out three major issues. Who all have embraced sustainability as a strategy, not as a reporting? Please remember, I am not talking on reporting. Those who have embraced sustainability, embedded as a strategy, there are embraces. There are people who are very cautious. Haan, karenge, dekhenge, baat mein dekhenge, jarur karenge. These are all general words. But there are people who are not cautious, but they have embraced in reality. Now this embraces management practices has been brought out beautifully in how they differ from the cautious adopters. Let's go through that quickly. What does the typical embracer do? But before that, the survey highlights 60% of the companies surveyed have increased their commitment to the sustainability. The investment levels have varied, causing the embracers and the cautious adopters group. Benefits have been experienced in terms of resource management and waste minimization. Brand building benefits were seen really high by those who have embraced sustainability. There is a tremendous struggle with measuring that intangible benefits of sustainability, but still there are very strong attempts to measure. Companies have started agreeing on acting on sustainability is linked with competitiveness. It is just not a big slogan or a talk shop. And there are certain management traits of embracers who have gone into that fast. We'll quickly go through that management traits of embracers as per this Boston Consulting Group survey. Number one, those embracers have moved into the sustainability thinking very early, even if the information is incomplete. I don't need a 99% complete information. With whatever information I have moved into that. Those embracers have balanced long-term objectives with the near-win projects. It's not as if I need to have only the long-term objectives and lose on the short-term. They have picked up projects which are near-winning projects, and they have balanced it with the long-term objectives. Sustainability is always a both top-down and a bottom-up approach. Aggressively de-siloed sustainability, meaning de-siloed, meaning it is defragmented, made into simple terms of understanding, and even an aam aadmi, someone working in a canteen, someone working in a gate as a security, they also understand sustainability because I have de-siloed. Measurements have been made even in very, very innovative areas, even if found challenging. Valuing the intangible benefits seriously have started, and they have tried to be really authentic and esteem and with conviction they are telling what they are doing, and that too transparently both internally and externally. The Boston Consulting Group has said these are all the seven management traits of embracers. Next. Let me come to the important part of this Prince of Wales accounting for sustainability, because there are certain important nuggets in this. Let me go straight to the second point. The integrated reporting which has come about now, and the criticism on the GRI also has come in a way that the sustainability movement has left out the accountants. The IFRS also has left out the accounting impact of sustainability, and reporting framework and concepts like GRI, they are more on the non-financial factors like carbon footprints, etc. They are not talking from a monetization angle. If you remember the video shown in the beginning, it starts talking of costing the earth, how much it costs to do this, how much it's monetization of the impact what you are causing. That is being highlighted in this accounting for sustainability. One important point I am telling, the inadequacy of the current forms of financial reporting, even if you take the case of IFRS, IFRS. The fundamental difficulty in IFRS is, in terms of obligations which are constructive, where you are not able to legally pinpoint, or you are legally pinpointing, it is fair enough. If it's not legally pinpointable, the firms have not acknowledged or admitted the obligation, then it cannot be brought into the impact of the IFRS. Suppose I am polluting the environment and there is no legal obligation. The pollution impact is likely to be faced 20 years later, 30 years later. So there is going to be a huge impact on the earth. IFRS doesn't expect you to monetize it unless there is a legal liability or you have admitted as an obligation. Whereas an IFRS framework gets into that. You need to quantify it. You need to show it as a financial impact. And this is what is being brought into the integrated reporting, the six forms of capital I told you, excluding the financial capital. If you have damaged the social infrastructure, one of the capital is called social infrastructure capital or physical infrastructure capital. If you are damaging the environment, if you are damaging the water sources, if you are damaging even the bridges and culverts created by the government, then to what extent you are depleting the value of the society, that needs to be quantified and brought in this integrated reporting. Whereas this is not expected to be done in the IFRS standards also. This has been pointed out as a major drawback in this Prince of Wales project in accounting for sustainability, and that is how this costing of the earth project has come. So you will find here the last point I am coming to is because of the different forms of capital, the six forms of capital other than the shareholder capital, the remaining five models need to be brought in, and hence this A4S is now on a very important project called true cost accounting. So what is a true cost accounting model? True cost accounting model is something which is, you don't construct a product cost based on the profit and loss account and the general ledger of the recorded transactions within a company. If you are manufacturing an air conditioner, let us say for example, and this air conditioner, the product design, it is costing, let us say, Pakistan rupees 20,000 rupees. It is going into the market. Whereas as per the ledger, the costing is 20,000. True cost accounting will say your cost is not 20,000. So what will be the true cost accounting it will be expecting you to do? It will have to get into the externalities. Thousands and thousands of air conditioners which you are pumping into the market to the customers. If that is going to deplete the ozone layer, spoil the limited finite resource of the earth, that means you are damaging the resource of the earth. Impute a cost of that and put it into that 20,000 air conditioner. You will find the true cost of that air conditioner may not be 20,000, it will be 200,000. And you are damaging the environment. And that stamp will fall on that product, that your product may be cost effective at the factory, but not in the society. And that is the attempt of the true cost accounting model. These are all now being developed as a thought leadership process in that A4S organization in London. What I am saying is, we should get into all this sort of looking like exotic concepts or very, very fuzzy ideas. We should be able to catch on and we should tell the world that we are capable of doing this. What is the reason for this? I am telling you, the basic reason for this, all these concerns are embedded into us basically. How many of you have noticed the beautiful recitation by the Kamran Saab, the beginning? Kamranji's recitation of Quran in the beginning itself, it contained lot of concepts on sustainability. The only thing is, we are not able to relate all this into this world of accountancy. What all we need to do is sit patiently and get into the act and be the thought leader for the world. And I am sure we can do that. Next slide. I'm about to finish. The latest is the discussion paper on the integrated reporting. I have touched on this various aspects and hence I will not take time. It was released on September 13th, 2011 for global discussion. This discussion paper has raised several conceptual questions and nightmares for the corporate reporting. It moves away from financial reporting alone. You can't report to only one stakeholder, that is a shareholder on the P&L account and the balance sheet and asset. No, that is not sufficient. Look at the stakeholder view, the society, the environment, the government, a broader reporting has to be done. And finally, the measurement will have to indicate movements in the various forms of capital. The crux is how the reporting can bring in the fact that the business model is creating value to all the stakeholders and not only